It's Andre from High Performance Academy. Welcome along to this week's webinar. Today we're going to be talking about the topic of idle speed control, and I know this is an area that a lot of tuners really struggle with. It's going to really kind of follow on a little bit from last week's webinar where we talked about cold start tuning, as we'll find out as we go through the webinar. The two do kind of work hand in hand, so really important to have a good understanding of both of these topics if you want to be able to replicate OE style drivability, or particularly idle speed control and cold start performance. Before we do get into the webinar though, I'll just cover off what's been going on around the shop over the last week. And I actually want to start with a Instagram photo that I've got on my laptop screen. So we'll head across there. And this is a little bit of an update on our FD3 RX7. Unfortunately, it has been a little bit slow to get some work done on this. We've just got that much going on. But we did get a chance to test fit our turbo source or turblown performance cast stainless steel exhaust manifold on the car last week, and just test fit it, see how much clearance we've got around everything. And we've got here the two TurboSmart external wastegates that are going on this manifold. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about the external wastegates and also the integration with this manifold. And I know I have actually touched on this a little bit in a previous webinar, but I know we get a lot of new people coming along to these, so I just want to talk about it anyway. It is a little hard to see in this photo here, but I'm going to start by talking about the wastegate integration. And all this really comes down to getting good, rock solid, stable boost control. And this is something I see so frequently done poorly. And that is the way the wastegate comes off the exhaust manifold or the exhaust runner. In this case, we've got two runners from a 13B engine. We've got one wastegate per runner. And what we're trying to do here, which again is a little tricky to see in that photo, is get a nice, smooth integration with our exhaust gas. So it's just as easy for it to go down the manifold runner towards the turbocharger as it is to exit out through the wastegate when that wastegate valve opens. And the reason for this is really it sort of comes down to fluid dynamics. You don't need to be a fluid dynamicist to be able to get this or figure this out. Really, what we need to understand is that exhaust gas is lazy. It doesn't really like changing direction. So if we're going to go and whack that external wastegate onto the side of our manifold at a horrible angle, maybe 90 degrees to exhaust flow, or worse still, I've seen this done so many times, where the exhaust gas actually has to back up on itself, go through almost 180 degrees in order to get out of the wastegate. Well, it's not going to do that very easily. It's got a lot of velocity behind it. It's got a lot of inertia. It doesn't really want to change direction. So first of all, in order to get good boost control, we need to make the wastegate easy to access for the exhaust flow, so it's just as simple to go out the wastegate. And particularly, this is going to make a big difference getting rid of that high RPM boost creep that we quite often see with inferior manifold designs. Now, beyond that, the manifold can only do so much. We also do need to have the correct size wastegate, and in this case we are running a pair of TurboSmart comp gate 40, so 40 mil external wastegate. As we've seen the wastegate technology evolve, I mean, it is a fairly well sorted technology now. There's not a lot of new stuff going on, but what we have seen is TurboSmart have managed to make these wastegates get smaller and smaller. Of course, that's important because it can be quite tricky packaging these into a tight modern engine bay with a lot going on. So in particular, the cap here has shrunk down considerably compared to their older wastegates, and also they've gone through a complete redevelopment of the base of the wastegate to get them to flow better. So these actually flow more air now, more exhaust gas, than a 40 mil wastegate in the past would have flown. So it flowed, I should say. So we're actually getting better control with a smaller wastegate. And the other feature that I wanted to talk about here is with these wastegates, we have gone with TurboSmart's sensor cap design. So this takes a little sensor. I've got one of them here. It's going to screw into the cap, and this just gives us wastegate position. This is something that TurboSmart have had available for a little while, although more recently they have updated this system. It was found that on the older style sensor caps, first of all, they were quite big and bulky, so again, made that packaging a bit of an issue. The connectors in particular were quite unreliable on those, because obviously being mounted onto the external wastegate, they are subject to a fair bit of temperature. And so the key key there was with the older wastegate caps, we saw a lot of people potting the cap as opposed to using the connector. As you can see here, it's supplied with a flying lead, so you can terminate this however you like. You can use a DTM connector if you want to keep it on a budget, or you can terminate this in an auto sport connector, 22 gauge tefzel wire, so it's all high grade stuff there, so it just depends on your budget. So the key with the position sensor caps is it is a really great tool for diagnosing exactly what's going on in the boost control system, particularly when you've got two wastegates. We may see this with a twin turbo system, each with an external wastegate as well. We can monitor whether we've got an imbalance in the wastegate opening, and particularly if you're at the track, you've got a boost leak or something like that that's not immediately apparent, that data can be absolutely invaluable for helping quickly diagnose and fault find what's going on, saving you precious time and getting the car back out on track quicker. All right, moving on, we also have had a fair bit of progress on our Toyota 86s, and I say 86s, we've got two of them that we are working on at the moment. We'll head across to my laptop screen for a start, and we have been in the process of putting back together our Subaru FA20 engine from our turbocharged Toyota 86. So this is something I got stuck into a few weeks ago and then got sort of sidetracked with a bunch of other stuff that was going on. So it's called, lovingly, we've referred to it as our ghetto build. And the reason I'm calling it a ghetto build is because we've tried to go with a relatively low budget approach here, and we're only addressing what we've found to be the key weakness this far with what we've been doing with this engine, which is the conrod. So on my laptop screen at the moment, we can see we've got a set of Brian Crower H-beam rods fitted to the engine now with a set of ARP 2000 rod bolts. We've bent rods in two of these engines, actually not from power alone, it's actually been from anti-lag that's caused that issue. So interesting there, because this engine has been making around about double the factory power on our mainline dyno running E85 for approximately 4 years now. We've had the car since brand new, and the only issues we've actually had are from the anti-lag strategy. So not ideal, probably wouldn't recommend anti-lag if you've got a turbocharged FA20 that is still running stock rods. So what we've done is we've kept the factory cast pistons. And people would often ask, well, why have you done that? And the reason for this is that while it does seem like adding a set of forged pistons at the same time would be relatively cost effective, the reality is that the cost of the pistons alone actually isn't the biggest factor. When we add forged pistons, we also have to have the engine block bored and honed to suit those larger diameter or first oversized pistons, get our piston to cylinder wall clearance correct. And at the same time, when we are doing this, it means that we've got to strip our engine completely down to a bare block. Now, it doesn't sound like much, but that extra work combined with our machining bill plus freight to and from our machinist, it really does add up to be a reasonably substantial hit. So we're sort of working on the basis here of, if it isn't broken, don't fix it. And we're really not aiming to push this engine much harder than we already are. We're running around about the 250 to 260 kilowatt mark on our mainline dyno, and that's on E85 at about 9 psi of boost. So another thing I wanted to talk about here is the valve. You can see I've gone through and I've lightly lapped all of the valves. So you might struggle a little bit to see it, but that's that light gray line that you can see on the valve seat face. I just want to talk about the technique of lapping, because this is an area that I get asked about a little bit, and it's important to understand that lapping is a technique that used to be quite common, probably a couple of decades back, for getting our valves seating quite nicely. The problem is that while lapping does a reasonably good job of getting our valve to seat when the engine is all cold at room temperature, what it actually produces, if you really inspect the valve seats and the valve surface close up, is it produces a concave surface on one side and a convex surface on the other side. And the issue with this is, as the valve heats up and expands, it means that we're going to end up with a really poor valve seat. So these days we don't use lapping. We're much more likely to have our valve seats cut professionally by our engine machinist, and as long as the angles there match for the valve seat and the surface of the face of the valve, we're not going to know that they're seated properly. If you want to get a little bit flasher, there are CNC valve seating machines available, getting a much more accurate result. Now, that may also bring up the question of why have I lapped these valves? Well, there is still a place for lapping as long as we understand the implications. And what I'm using it for here is just to get an idea of the valve seating condition and the shape and width of that valve seat. And what we're using here is a very light lapping paste, and we're not going crazy on it. All it is a case of doing here is putting a small dab of our fine valve grinding paste on the valve seat, and then we're just going to basically be giving that valve a couple of light turns. And all we're trying to look for here is this gray discoloration that we can see on the valve face. That shows us, first of all, that we have got good seating all the way around the valve. It's also showing us the width of the valve seat, which is just as important, particularly on the exhaust valve side. We're going to have a wider seat, which is important to make sure that it can dissipate the heat out of the head of the valve. So used correctly, it is a valuable tool. We just don't want to be going and actually trying to grind new valve seats using a valve grinding paste and that lapping procedure. It's going to end up with a horrible result that's only going to end up sealing properly at room temperature. Now, the other couple of upgrades we have used on this FA20 Ghetto build, we have gone with an HKS head gasket and a set of ARP head studs. The HKS head gasket, the reason we've gone with that is that we are a little bit thicker in the head gasket thickness compared to stock. We're on to about 0.7 millimeters on the HKS gasket. This is just going to help reduce our compression ratio very slightly because we are still at 12.5 to 1, quite high, understandably, for a turbocharged engine. Really, the only reason we're getting away with this is because we are running direct injection and E85 to boot. On top of that, just to again aid with our cylinder head sealing, we've gone with a set of ARP head studs. So nothing too extravagant there, but should be a nice upgrade over stock. Now, I also just wanted to talk about the cam chain design on the FA20, and this sort of brings me to a point that is really important to understand when you are undertaking any engine build, and that is, it's always a good idea to start by sourcing a copy of the factory workshop manual. And particularly with the cam chain design on the FA20, it's not rocket science, but there are a few little tricks that you do need to keep in mind to make sure that you get the engine timed up correctly without the potential for bending any of the valves. And this is one of the engines where I don't really think, unless you were very familiar with it, you'd be able to get this right without following the step-by-step workshop manual procedure. So the question, of course, comes down to where are you going to find these manuals. For most engines that I work with, they're really easy to find with maybe 5 to 10 minutes of searching on Google on the internet. If you're dealing with a popular engine, particularly one that's Japanese, then almost inevitably someone's going to have been helpful enough to upload a copy of that workshop manual. Where you can get into a little bit of trouble is if you're dealing with something that isn't a popular engine for modification, or alternatively, if you are dealing with a brand new engine that's only just come out, it may take a little bit of time before workshop manuals do become available. Last photo I think I've got on the FA20 here. This is just a shot of our custom baffled sump here. So this is one of the first weak points we found in the FA20 when we started tracking the car hard, even when this was naturally aspirated and when it was still on stock tires. We were finding that we were getting fairly consistent oil surge, and these engines are given a pretty bad reputation for bearing problems. And the reality is that more often than not, if the car is driven hard on a racetrack, it will be a case of oil starvation, and in that case, if there's no oil making it to the bearings, they're not going to last very long. This is actually made worse as well by the fact that in stock form there is no oil cooler. Even when our engine was naturally aspirated, we were seeing oil temperatures reaching 140 degrees C quite regularly and quite easily out on the racetrack, obviously made worse with a turbocharger. So it's really important to control that oil temperature as well as to baffle the sump to make sure that you've always got a good supply of oil at the pickup. So this is kind of a poor man's dry sump system. Really, it's one step below a dry sump system, but much, much cheaper. And you can also see the gold foil that we've put on here just to try and reflect heat, because the exhaust manifold does run really close to that sump as it comes around the front of the engine. And we've also got another heat shield here. This sits just above, obviously the engine's upside down, this sits just above the exhaust housing of the turbocharger. And in particular, we are protecting here, we've got one of the VVT solenoids as well as the cam position sensor center, which is just out of sight. Didn't really want to end up melting that wiring. So that is our Subaru FA20 engine. Hopefully should be finished after this webinar is complete. If you are on Instagram, you can check out our story. I've been updating that fairly regularly over the last 2 days as I've been building that engine, so there's still a bunch of detail in there. Check that out. So yeah, hopefully that'll be ready to go in. We are potentially racing the white 86 this weekend. Now, continuing on with the 86 theme, we are still completing the gearbox installation in our black V8 powered 86. So this is our TTI sequential 6-speed box, and we can see here we've got our gearbox crossmember made up by our local fabricator. And I'm just in the process at the moment, well, the next step will be making up some linkages for our shifter. Here we go. So this is an awkwardly positioned photo, but that's the shifter coming through the top of the transmission tunnel. So obviously these gearboxes go into a variety of different cars. So they're basically supplied with this universal aluminium linkage kit that needs to be cut and then threaded to suit. So we've got that happening, and we are waiting for the drive shaft to come back for that that car. So that's a shot of our sequential shifter up in the inside the car. So this particular gearbox as well is a little unique in that it uses two separate levers. We've got one for our forward gears, first through to six, and then we've got a separate reverser. So this particular lever system converts that back into a single lever, and we can see there's this red lockout here, which allows us to move the whole lever system between selecting reverse or our forward gears. The last thing that remains, we're waiting for the courier to drop off our strain gauge gear knob, so we're going to be able to perform clutchless upshifts, and also the EC will be able to perform an auto blip on our downshift. Last little part of that puzzle there as well is with this particular gearbox setup, we are running a custom bell housing which uses a tilt and throwout bearing or clutch release bearing. So this is a hydraulic release bearing internal inside the gearbox, and the problem with this is we need to fit an external bleed valve. So this is what we've got here at the moment. It's just hanging down. Once we've got this all installed for the final time, this will be mounted up in the engine bay, so this is quite easy to access when we do go through the process of bleeding up the clutch. All right, so that's a bit of an update on our Toyota 86s. We should be hopefully having both of them running in the very near future. And lastly, I just wanted to talk about our latest video that has just gone live a few hours ago. We'll head across to my laptop screen. So this is a video that Jono and I shot when we were at TX2K in Texas a month or so ago. This is Stuart from T1 Race, his S2000. It's a car that we actually spotted when we were at Airstrip Attack in Pikes Peak last year, and I was pretty impressed with the car. We decided that we wanted to do a tech tour of the car, and the reason I think that cars like this are really valuable to get some insight on is because at an event where there were maybe 40 or 50 R35 GTRs, probably the majority of which were producing more than 1500 wheel horsepower, it can kind of get lost in a sea of sort the same. It's nice to see something that is a little bit different. And also, I think for a lot of enthusiasts out there, when they're looking at some of these high-end drag car builds where the budget's probably north of $300,000 or $400,000 US, it's a little bit hard to relate to this. So the S2000, obviously not the most expensive car in the world, although Stuart's definitely poured a number of paychecks into modifying it, but the results are pretty impressive. So we get to chat to Stuart and find out exactly what makes that car tick. While you're over on our YouTube channel watching that, please make sure you subscribe. All right guys, give us a few seconds and we'll get started with today's webinar.